A very good morning and a warm welcome to Exmouth Baptist Church and to our remembrance service today. It's really good to see so many folks here, both in the church and also we think of all those people that can't be with us and maybe watching our service virtually. So we pray that they'll know the love and blessings from us all in this church congregation. Our message today is brought to us by Pastor Mike. It's entitled, How Can I Be Free From Sin? And for anybody that's tuning in that doesn't know me, my name is Pamela. And I pray that we'll all be inspired, challenged and blessed by the Holy Spirit today. For those people that are church members, just advance notice that in 2 weeks' time, on the 29th, we'll be having our church meeting. So that's the 29th is our next church meeting. We continue to socially distance in the church and would encourage everybody who is able to keep their masks on so we stay safe, please. So we begin on this Remembrance Sunday with some words of scripture. Psalm 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Psalm 121, verse 1 and 2. I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Lamentations 3, verses 21 to 23. This I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. And Isaiah 40, verse 31. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not be weary. They will walk and not be faint. Our next two hymns echo those verses that we've just had from the Bible. They speak of a God who is steadfast, who has guided us through all the seasons of our life, but gives us hope for the future. So we can be truly grateful. So as we stand to sing, let's do it with passion and thankfulness in our hearts. So we begin with Lord for the years, and during this first hymn, we will be taking our offering.
Sold us and saved us, Lord, the I often think what wonderful words. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of changing, turning with thee. What wonderful words as we come to sing. How God has always been with us throughout wars, throughout trouble, pestilence. God is our constant companion. Let's sing, great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest good, but all that you fulfill not. As old as me, and forever will be.
Together. Almighty God, we thank you that on this morning of remembrance, we can remember your great faithfulness to us, your presence to cheer and to guide us, giving us great strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. We remember the lessons of the past. The cost of war, the price of peace, and the extent of human self-sacrifice. Help us to commit ourselves to work for reconciliation between nations, that all people may together live in freedom, justice, and peace. We pray for all who in bereavement, disability and pain continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and of terror. And we remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts, past and present, have been given and taken away. Almighty God, we come remembering all you have done throughout history. And we offer our gifts to you in monetary terms, thankful for all you've done in this place and throughout the world. May we never forget your blessings to us. And thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we experience afresh today a move of your Holy Spirit. Speak to our hearts. And as our hymn just said, set our hearts ablaze. We ask these things through the precious name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to be very controversial, music team, before you sit down. We're going to have another hymn. Mike and Steve, sorry, I'm changing the order of service. So we're going to have O God, Our Help in Ages Past, please, just to fit in with the timings. Before we come towards our time of remembrance, I don't know what sort of week you've had. I've had a really busy one. I came back from London at 10 o'clock last night, so I'm feeling pretty tired. So forgive me if I haven't got my usual vibrancy. But let's just all take a few moments to just reflect on all the past months, the past year, the past many years have meant to all of us at this time of remembrance. So let's just take a few minutes to ourselves to bring to God perhaps your personal prayers, and then I'll read to you a poem.
Lord, however we've come this morning, I pray that you will receive our worship as we hear the sounds of acts of remembrance out in our town. I pray that the love and the comfort of Christ will be known to all. Lord, in this national time of remembrance, when we're so grateful for all you've done in ages past, we look to you as our God of hope for the future. So as people gather around cenotaphs up and down the country, we ask, Lord God, that you'll speak to every individual heart to be their Lord of compassion. And for each individual here, Lord, who has memories of loved ones, I pray, Lord God, you will minister in the quiet and the silence to each and every person. Thank you, Lord, that you call us together as a fellowship. Thank you, we are united in you. Whatever our differences, Lord, I pray that through Christ we are the one body. We use our gifts together and we're grateful for all you've done in and through Jesus. Accept our prayers this morning. Amen. I'm going to read a poem called Tears of Victory. There were crowds in the streets of London the day the peace was signed. They sang in exultation. They danced, they whined, they dined. For the dreadful war was over, the slaughter at an end. And now at last a broken world could slowly start to mend. Set among the celebrations, the cheerful, happy cries, a multitude were weeping, no laughter in their eyes. For these, there was no reason to share the festive mood. Their hearts were bowed with sorrow, their every thought subdued. For while the throng around them gave vent to shouts of joy, they thought of dads or brothers, of cousins, nephews too, of uncles, colleagues trusted, friends that they once knew. So when some talk of glory, of mighty deeds once done, think also of the suffering with which it all was won. And when they speak of victory upon that glorious day, remember all those buried in fields so far away. It's true that time is a healer, and it was a long time ago. It's true we've learned to live with the ones we once called foe. But many still are haunted by the thoughts of those they've lost, still struggling with their feelings, still counting the cost. So if you would pay tribute and honour those who fell, and work for peace and justice, and make your freedom tell, there is a way more fitting that we can repay the debt if we keep on saying that we will not forget. Let's take a moment. And I'm permanently changing the order of service today, so forgive me, those of you that are helping me to lead, but we're just going to have an additional hymn, 122 in Mission Praise, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. I don't know if we've got the words, have we, Craig? Probably not. Eternal Father, Strong to Save. If not, we can go back to the old way of using hymn books. Phil, could you just... Oh, you've got it, okay. So spontaneous. Thank you, guys. Do have a seat. So we will come shortly to our time of remembrance, and I'm going to say some words And at the end of it, and I'll make it clear to you, if you can just join in with the words, we will remember them. So at the end of what I say, I'll make it clear, you will say, we will remember them. An older person says, they shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. A younger person may reply, at the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. And we say together, we will remember them. We'll just pause a moment to think. Thank you. Let's pray together. Ever-living God, we remember those whom you have gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May that same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all peoples, establish harmony among nations, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Do have a seat. And it's on the act of remembrance that Alice is now going to come and share with us.
Good morning. I just want to say something before I forget what I said. I was asking God the significance for the memory tree. And I wasn't expecting to bring my son's dragon tree in today. I was expecting to bring in some dead branches that have been cut off. But that signifies death and dying and decay. But I looked at my son's dragon tree today, and it's vibrant, and it's green, and it's verdant, and it lives on. And then I saw the hearts in the Christmas decoration, and that's our hearts. And there's messages there from people. So people don't die. They live on in our hearts. And I want to share something. You see the two tapestries there, the embroidery? My son did those. And that one up there is very special because my granddad, Rex Clayton, is on the left, and Peter's granddad, Thomas Edge, is on the right. They both fought in the Battle of the Somme 100 years ago. And another strange thing is that Thomas Edge, my husband's grandfather, was in the North Staffordshire Regiment, and my granddad, Rex Clayton, was in the South Staffordshire Regiment. So they probably trained together before they went out to war, and their paths probably crossed. And I find that really, really amazing. They both survived, but my granddad Rex, he went right up to the front line and he was shot directly in the shoulder by a German. And he lay there all day, wounded. And this was when they first went out over No Man's Land at about, 6 o'clock in the morning. And he lay there the rest of the day. You'd imagine the cacophony and the noise. We've all seen War Horse, haven't we? And it was just like that. And this stretcher bearer, and that represents that the stretcher bearers there, the Gomcourt Wood with the trees and all the mud. The stretcher bearers prodded him at the end of the day, and he moved, and they put him on a stretcher, and they carried him off, and they looked after him. And it's just so significant. And because he survived, I'm here, and I want to carry on. And Peter's here because his granddad survived, and I just want to carry on the message and what these brave people did for us, not just the First World War, but lots of other wars. And also, as a mother of two young sons, I think about, there's a tribute last night which was so, so moving. The mothers whose children did not come back from the war. And there's people here whose children have passed away. And also, want to remember there's people there who signify everybody in this room family members have passed away. I put them there to represent each one of us whose family members have passed away. And if you want to put something on the memory tree, there's a chance to do some craft in the at coffee time. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Alice. I think we can all identify with different stories of war. I know for myself, my father was in the Second World War. He was a sergeant in the Devon and Dorset Regiment, and Remembrance Day was very special for him. So I'm sure as each one of us here has our memories and our stories, it's good for those memories to live on, isn't it? So we come now to prayers of intercession. There is no fresh pastoral news, so I'm just going to incorporate anything that is relevant into our prayers of intercession. So let's pray together. Our prayers today will be in sections, and after each one, I will say the words, "May God give peace." And once I've said those words, can I ask you to join in and say, "God give peace." So when I say, "May God give peace," you say, "God give peace." Let's pray for all who suffer as a result of conflict and ask for God's peace. For the service men and women who have died in violence of war, in acts of terrorism, each one remembered and known to God. May God give peace. God give peace. We pray for all those mourning loved ones through conflicts, through the pandemic, or in the natural pattern of life, whether recently or in the past, and whose grief remains very real to them. We lay before God the sadness of loss, the distressing grief, and we especially think of those in our own congregation who had more recent losses. For Jodie, for Josie and John, for Jan Pratt, Jan White, Alice and Pete. May God give peace. God give peace. We pray for all our armed forces who face danger each day. We remember their family, their friends, and all who pray for their safe return. We also think of civilian women, men, and children whose lives are disfigured by war, terror, or acts of hatred. And we especially think of all those in Afghanistan. May God give peace. God give peace. We pray for peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep our world secure and free. For all those in leadership, in politics, the military, the church, we ask for the gift of wisdom and a resolve to search for reconciliation. May God give peace. And finally, we pray for all those today who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, for those that are persecuted for their faith, And we pray before God for those in our fellowship who need a special touch of God's healing power today. And we'll just take a few seconds for you in your own thoughts to name those people. We pray for our Pastor Mike, for Sue, for wisdom for their future. That the Spirit will come in power upon Mike as he preaches to us shortly. May God give peace. God of truth and justice, we lift our eyes above the torment of our broken world as we honour the past. May we put our faith in you as our future. For you are the source of life and hope, both now and in eternity. Amen. Amen. And I'm just going to give today's reading. So today's reading is taken from 1 Peter 4, verses 12 to 19. The words are up there on the screen. Suffering for being a Christian. Dear friends, do not be surprised at that fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in as much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any kind of criminal, or even a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. We thank God for his word. And our next song picks up how we can humble ourselves before the cross of Jesus, to be freed from sin.
How can I be free from sin? Lead me to the cross of Jesus, from the guilt, the power, the pain. Lead me to the cross of Jesus. There's no other way, no price I could pay. Simply to the cross I cling. This is what I need, this is what I plead. Of Jesus, sing a song of joy. loving love from the Father's heart to me. What a gift of grace, His own righteous death clothed me in His purity. How can I live day to day? Lead me to the cross of Jesus.
I thought that this would be a very apt subject for us to look at this morning. I know we've been going through the book of Hebrews, but this morning we look at the world that has been so torn and such tragedy. It's not just the First World War or the Second World War. We've had many conflicts where our and other countries' troops have gone in to defend the rights of those who have none. So when we look at 1 to 4 and verse 12, Peter tells us that we shouldn't be surprised at the painful trials we are suffering, as though something strange were happening. Well, those of you who know your scripture, Jesus said that it would not be an easy ride for those who would pick up their cross and walk. Did he not? He said that the world will not be full of kindness. And this stretches right back. Look at man's disobedience. Go to Genesis. Don't eat the apple, eat anything else. But man, in his pride and his self-reliance, ate the fruit. And throughout history, we've seen a world come that reveres God less and less. And when you talk to people about God, what do they say? Well, if there's a God, why is there so much suffering in the world? Can't He stop it? As if it's God's fault. But think about this. If we didn't have free will that God has given us, we'd all be like automatons, wouldn't we? We'd all wear the same, we'd all think the same, we'd all be the same. But God gave us free will to choose between right and wrong. And most of the time man has chose wrong. Let's look at it. Greed, power, has been man's fuel for life. What if God did take away our free will? Would it not have been a mistake for God to give us that free will in the beginning? If He gave it and then took it away, if my child, I give a box of matches and he burns my house down, what would you say that was? Wrong? Well, we do not want that. Well, that's a sin, isn't it? So are we really saying that God is capable of sin? No. No, God gave us our free will. He wants us to love Him freely. You see, if we were automatons, we couldn't, could we? We'd be commanded to love Him. There would be no love in our heart for a God who sacrificed His Son. So no, God cannot be to blame for all the pain in this world. A chap once came to me and he said, he was going out with a Christian friend of mine and she wouldn't commit any further till he came to the Lord. And a conversation ensued in my home where he said this, if there's a God, Why is there war? I said, what's that got to do with God? He's a bit dumbfounded at first. What do you mean, what's that got to do with God? I said, simply that. What's he got to do with it? He threw up that the First World War ministers blessed tanks and blessed warships. I said, fair enough. I said, but what was the cause of war? Was it because of God or because of man's greed? And the answer came back, because of man's greed. So we cannot in all conscience say that God causes suffering and pain. No, God knows we're going to go through suffering and pain. But it is our free choice. Man has made that decision, not God. Then he said to me, well, why is there famine in the world? Why is the world suffering that? That's God's fault, isn't it? And my reply came back, is it? Is it really? Yes, of course it is. Oh, yeah. And how do you work that one out? Well, there's starving children in Africa. Yeah. I said, are you saying we don't produce enough food in this world to feed everybody? When there's butter mountains and wheat mountains and there's all this stuff that goes out of date before it can be used. No, my friend, it's not God that causes that suffering. It's man's selfishness and man's greed that causes that. Man's want of power and money. That's what causes hunger in this world. It's not that God does not supply the plentiful harvest. He does. It's man's choice, man's selfishness that causes hunger in the world. Man's selfishness. You only have to look at what's been happening in Glasgow. Man has a chance to start to put things right. At the last minute, India steps in and says, we won't say we're going to get rid of coal. We're going to work towards phasing it out. Weakened an agreement. Man's greed, man's power. And my friend said to me, okay, when I was in a relationship, had a baby. And for the want of an incubator, that baby died. That's God's fault. And I can never forgive him. And I said, it's not you that's got to forgive God. It's God's got to forgive you, my friend. Let's get that one straight first. Let's get that one started. I said, but how can you blame God? Well, he died. I said, yeah, but what's that got to do with God? I said, are you telling me when America and us spend trillions on arms, on nuclear weapons, on submarines, on land forces, that if they took 1% of that, trillions of pounds, there would be no suffering in the world. There would have been nurses, there would have been incubators. How can we blame God for man's greed? For man wanting to cause suffering? For man wanting to cause pain? Didn't know what to say. He had nothing to say. So he came up with the final one. His final objection, he said, why is the world so full of earthquakes, tsunamis, hurricanes, tornadoes? And my same reply came, what's that got to do with God? What do you mean, he said? If he's all powerful and all knowing, he could stop it. I said, who caused it? We have plundered this earth. If you go back into Genesis, this all starts there. And when God said, looked at the earth, what did he say? It was good. And we have done our level best as mankind to rip the heart out of this world. And then we wonder why we have all the calamities. Man's greed for gold, for diamonds, for coal,
for tin, for lead, for copper, which has led to wars over the said things. When we look and we say, how can the world be so full of pain? We need to look to ourselves. We need to look at each of us. Each of us in this world can make a change. Each of us can stop this world being so full of pain. The choice is ours, isn't it? It isn't anybody else's. It starts with one person. And this world in which we live is full of pain and suffering because of man's innate capacity to cause havoc, to kill, to torture, to maim. We cannot bring God into this equation and blame him for our own follies. It's time we, as a human race, stood up and said, enough. How many Christians do we reckon there is in the world? Millions, yes, would we agree? Millions. Yet still, we cannot stand together as one voice, and say, enough, stop. Because we get interdenominational fights. Surely we can all agree that this world is going to hell in a handcart. We should rejoice that Christ is allowing us to partake in this world, even though it can be hard, even though it brings suffering. We need to work even harder to tell those who cause this pain, who cause these wars, who cause this starvation, enough. And people say, but I'm only one voice. So are the 12. So was Christ. What did Isaiah say? A voice calling out in the wilderness. The only thing that's stopping this world from changing is us, ourselves, through fear that we'll fail. Fear that the job is too big. Yet I'm reminded of a scripture when God said, Jesus said this, that he greater things than I do, you'll do. But what we have is a heart of fear. Yes, we have a heart of love. Yes, we want to love the downtrodden. Yes, we want to love those who are persecuted. This war on this world against the enemy would be won by in one way. The Church of Christ falling to its knees en masse and asking God to intercede. Mary, Queen of Scotland, once said she feared one person more than any other. And that was the man that was on his knees praying to God to intercede. Dare we dream to pray big? That God will stop this world from suffering, from pain. And then we can rejoice that our participations are just like the sufferings of Christ. So that we may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. And that's going to come, my friends. What's going to happen is one day all this is going to end. And Christ is going to come. And you've got to remember this. We need to be strong. When Christ says there will be but a remnant of the church, what is he actually saying? What is he actually saying in this world of suffering and pain? What is he saying? Will it be that there are only a few churches? No. Think about what he said. There will be but a remnant who stay true. The church of today is twisting the Bible. It's making itself acceptable to that world so full of pain. We need preachers, men and women, to come out and stand on the gospel. That's what changed this world, my friends, is the power of the gospel. And no man or woman will be at the last day be able to say, well, I didn't know. We are the answer to the world's pain and suffering. Through prayer and calling upon God to intercede is how we will see this happen. Does anybody know when the church started its decline? After the First World War. Yeah? After the First World War, when so many sons and fathers did not come home. And people lost hope. We saw a decline. And it's been a steady decline since then. Why? Because the church has not been on its knees praying. I remember somebody telling me a story about Spurgeon. They asked him, one chap said, how did you bring so many people to faith? He said, firstly, it's not me that does it. He said, I haven't got time to talk to you now. I've got to go and preach. And so he preached. And a multitude came forward to give their hearts to Jesus. And they were received into the kingdom. Then this same man said, well, you're finished now. Can you tell me so I can do better than tell you? I can show you. And he went off. And he went to the back of the pulpit. And the man followed him. And there was this a door, and he opened that door and he went down about 10 steps. And downstairs there was 100 people, and all they were doing was praying that people would come to faith in that meeting. That hasn't changed, my friends. If we want to see this world of pain end, it's not by conventional arms that we will do it. No, it's not. It's by being on our knees and praying to God to intercede. Only God can change men and women's hearts. We can't do that. We can't do that. It's the power of the Holy Spirit which dwells in each of us. We have the power to call upon it, but do we? So if we really want to know what can be done, we can pray, my friends. Tell people of the gospel. And then when the day comes, as it says in 1 Peter, when it says there, it is hard for the righteous to be saved, but what will become of the ungodly, the sinner? Well, a lot of ministers don't say this now, but I'll tell you what's going to happen. They're going to be thrown into the lake of fire. Those people you know next door to you, who you have luncheons with, those people you go on holiday with who don't know the beauty of having Christ in their heart. They've got one way to go. It's a very wide road. Christ said that. The highway to damnation is wide. But let us, brothers and sisters, be the people who pray for those souls, who intercede for those souls. And pray that the Holy Spirit will act on the hearts of men and women so this world will no longer be so full of pain. You see, there's a reason why this earth is not like heaven. Because we don't want it to be. Mankind doesn't want it to be. It doesn't want it to be full of peace. The devil doesn't want it to be full of peace. He wants it full of conflict. Full of trouble, full of hatred. But this can be beaten by the power of the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. time. Where to is it? What time? Just a quick announcement. There'll be an outreach on the Strand on Thursday. Gordon and Wendy are part of it. But there's also a prayer meeting for all the churches at 10 o'clock at the Access Centre, the old ICFAS building, we'll all know it as, or Community Church Centre. All are welcome. It will be socially distanced. Please, if you can, go join with others to pray for this world in which we live, this town in which we live. Thank you.
Thank you. And I forgot to say in my welcome, a really good welcome back to Pearl. It's lovely to see you. And it's also lovely to see Rosemary back with us as well. So bless you, sisters. Good to see you both. So our final song, and it was very much as I saw that verse that Craig put up earlier, just before our act of remembrance from 1 Corinthians. It spoke about the trumpet sounding, not the last post, but the final trumpet, that we're going to be changed from what is perishable to imperishable. And that's a hope we have as Christians. We're set free by Jesus Christ, aren't we?
Amen.
We're no longer condemned. We stand by the grace of God. So our final song, I am a new creation, no more in condemnation. My love just keeps on growing.
I am a new creation, no more in condemnation. You're in the grace of
blessing. When you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we gave our today.
Amen.
To God, who is always forgiving, always loving, always offering us that new beginning, be honor and glory, praise and thanksgiving, this day and forevermore. Amen. And we say the words of the grace to each other.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
I'm assuming there's coffee. Is the mic? Yes. Do stay and join us for coffee in the hall.